Welcome.
I wasn't expecting that. Thank you. What a nice room. I look at all these faces, I can tell there's a lot of artists in here right now. Is that true? Maybe? Seems like an artsy crowd. Lots of familiar, kind, compassionate, inquisitive faces. So, very excited. I only have 2.5 minutes, so I'm going to keep it quick, okay? We've got a great speaker, as you know, coming up shortly. My name's Andrew Bronchi. I run the enterprise design practice for TopTel. And in case you haven't heard, TopTel is a global freelance marketplace where we can connect you with experts, industry experts, on demand. On the flip side, we have a community of freelancers, and we're all very excited about the work. We're all very connected. That's not what I want to talk about today, with a little bit of time that I have. I want to talk about a lot, the future of work, some lessons from Hollywood, and what I consider maybe the most important industry trend. 61 million people born in 1997 to the year 2000 are going to join the American workforce in the next 3 years. Now, of that generation who's already working, half of them are freelancing. Two-thirds of those freelancers are doing it not because they have bills to pay or a sofa they want to buy, but because they love the work. They're motivated by the variety. They like the challenges. Tonight, we're going to hear from a legend from Hollywood and a legend in freelancing. And if you think the future of work is freelancing, like I do, Hollywood's got a rich history of that that goes back maybe 100 years. So let's all take a lesson from Stephan. And I'd like to end with a question. So I've been asking myself again and again and again, would I be here today in this room with these people doing this thing that I love if it wasn't for Inspector Gadget? By the way, if any of this sounds interesting, you can find me by the banner over there. And without further ado, Stephan Martiniere.
All right, and good, I'm live. There we go. A lot of people have said, don't give Jay a mic, right? But I want to make sure we're recording this, and Stephan wanted to make sure we recorded this for posterity, proof that he was actually here, so the clients, you know, would let him more time on your deadlines, right, Stephan?
Yes, and make sure you're not going to say something too...
That's right. Okay, that's right.
So I can edit all that stuff.
All right, so cut. No, I'm kidding. Okay, so my name is Jay Schuh, and this is the first time we've done this kind of event. I don't know if we'll do it again next year. This is kind of an experiment. But I said, if I'm going to bring someone to do this kind of experiment, I couldn't think of anybody better than my friend Stephan Martiniere. So guys, please give Stephan a round of applause, and thank him for joining us today. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
All right, Stephan, we've got a lot of slides we got to get through.
We got right? A ton of stuff.
So you got an amazing story. So I think what we're going to do is we're just going to get started. How's that sound?
Let's do it.
Okay. So first thing we're going to do, Stephan, is talk about your influences. And I think for the folks in the room, you're one of the influences for some of the people in their room. But you had, way back when you started, some of your own influences, right?
And oh, yeah.
You kind of wanted to include some of your influences. So let's like quickly go through, what was this influence? Why was this important to you?
It's like, when I think back, I used to live in an environment in France at the time where you could easily say that was the golden age of comic books. During, you know, the end of the 70s and the 80s, I mean, it was exploding all over the place. So France was really at the forefront of new styles, you know, and tons of different stories and artists, you know, that you could imagine. And as a kid, I was bombarded. I was surrounded by these, and not only that, but being a part of a family of five, each one of us had our own magazines. And so we had our own things and we shared each other. So I was really exposed to not only everything that France and Belgium, you know, was offering in terms of comics, but also everything that was coming from the States as well. And the superhero, you know, was one big part of it, as well as, you know, the Disney universe that was already very, you know, relevant there at the time.
Now, you said so, Bambi resonated with you, right?
And I don't know why. You know, it's yeah. One of these things you watch, you're young kids, and maybe it's that scene when the mom dies,
yeah.
You know, and I was crying, and I was like, the whole emotional, and to even to a point where I had to stay for a second showing right after the first one because I wanted to see her again.
It touched you that much?
Yeah, it did. It did, actually. It's one of his things. And you don't know really exactly why. It's like the Silver Surfer. Why the Silver Surfer at all, the superhero? He was the one I really liked the most. Maybe because I thought he was the most powerful. And maybe because it was before finding out Superman was there.
That's true.
But then, you know, Superman was never my thing. You know, Silver Surfer, I don't know, there was something about surfing, I don't know, in space. Maybe that was just the beginning of, like, thinking I would maybe go there one day or so.
Now, it wasn't just American comics, right?
No, yeah, that's true. I mean, American was part of it, you know, and there was, on top of the superhero that were there, there was also all the horror comics that was also present there. Guys like Bernie Wrightson, Vampire, you know, that was there. Fred Zera, you know, was one, a part of these magazines. Jeff Jones, and all these guys were also happening there. And particularly Bernie Wrightson, I mean, that was awesome. I mean, when I saw that guy, it was just like a game changer. So, you know, I started designing superhero, and then suddenly I was designing monsters with spandex and stuff like that. I mean, you start mixing everything because you're just receiving so much influence, you know, and then it kept on going. Yeah, it kept on going.
And we, I passed really quickly. Talk a little bit about this. Why did this influence you? This is kind of different.
Yeah, I've always been, it's interesting, I've always been attracted both by the realistic style and the serious things in terms of fantasy and sci-fi, but I was also very much into cartoons. I love cartoons. I mean, I love Disney, so right. I was already kind of part of what, but there was also so much cartoons going on in the comics in France also, as well as the realistic stuff, that I was just drinking it both ways. And you know, that stayed with me. I mean, that whole influence of wanting to do cartoons for animation as well as wanting to do realistic, you know, and hardcore sci-fi was always been part of my universe.
Now, this is much more kind of, I would say, in line with kind of an early influence of what you do now.
That's true, actually. Right. I still sometimes, you know, remember all that stuff and just even integrate stuff. And that stuff was very early on. I mean, it's interesting because I used to buy, which is good to know for people who want to be in a book cover industry, I used to buy books solely for their covers. And I was totally in love with that artist. I think this guy was a game changer in the industry. What's very interesting too is that this guy was a game changer in the book cover industry and illustrations in terms of how he portrayed spaceships and the idea of space. But it took Hollywood, you know, 20 years to catch on, right, to wanting to use this kind of stuff, which was finally kind of used on the Guardians of the Galaxy. So it took that long for Hollywood, because the stuff is so radical.
Yeah.
It takes a while for an audience to accept something that is so different. And to me, I was extremely attracted. And that guy from England was doing all these book covers for science fiction writers. And I just fell in love with that. And I kept buying books, which has got me exposed to all the writing and stories of science fiction. So that was kind of a very...
And we're going to... Sorry, my clicker has a life of its own today. But we're going to talk a little bit about books now. So you said books and sci-fi. What really, with this series of books, what influenced you? What stayed with you from these books? It was Dune. Right?
Dune, obviously. I mean, that's a big, big one. I mean, you read that book, and it's so big anyway. The scope, and it's not even just one book. I mean, it, you know, started with three, and then they picked it up, and it started to go all over the place on that stuff. It's just the story was so relevant because it is so relevant. You know, the context itself is what we live in anyway. The politics, the economy, the system that's established, you know, the religion that's been brought in the process and stuff. I mean, it was a very, very complex story. So that's one thing that stayed, you know, real, real deep with me. And then other books, I mean, this one, for example, I don't know why also, it's like Bambi and stuff. I just read that story. And it's a small story. It's not really anything earth-shattering, you know, but the story of these guys going underwater and crossing the oceans and living that adventure, it's like, I think it brought me back to the 20,000 leagues under the sea, which I was already, you know, very enamored with. But also, I think, you know, I don't know, it's an interesting question because I don't know if these kinds of writing got me interested in wanting to do scuba diving, which I did later on because I was so much into that, or it's something else. You know, but I think also the whole idea of being in an environment where you float when you're weightless, because even as a kid when I was growing and watching the first man on the moon and everything that was happening with space, you know, I always was in love with the idea of being able to go out there one day, if that was ever possible. And so the thing about underwater, I mean, I think it's totally tied to that in some ways.
And you mentioned that these book covers really kind of settled with you, right? In your subconscious a little bit.
Yeah. Oh, they do. I think everything that you see kind of stays with you in one form or another. You know, either you reject it or you totally embrace it, and then it becomes part of, you know, what you're looking for and what you do with and stuff like that. Yeah.
All right. You call this the heavy metal years.
That's
right?
True. Yeah.
And this was when you were in school. Talk a little bit, because there's some students in this room, so talk a little bit about where your head was when you started school, because we're going to go further from here, right? But when you started school, what were you thinking?
Well, it's interesting, because I was never thinking about an art school, because I didn't know it even existed.
Right.
I was just doing school stuff, doing my art class with, you know, like everybody else, without thinking much about being serious about that. And it's a friend of mine that told me, when I was ready to graduate, he said, so what are you going to do next? I said, I don't know. I mean, I know I love to draw, and I love comic books, and I want to do more art, but I really had no sense. I was really very naive about what was out there. And I came from a small town, so it was not really obvious that I was exposed to possibilities. And a friend says, hey, you know, there is art school. You know, you could continue what you're doing, but doing seriously. So I say, oh, all right. So then I talked to my teacher about that, and it's good to remember, when I mentioned that to my teacher, I says, oh yeah, I did that school. And I had spent 2 years with a teacher learning to draw, and she never mentioned it until I one day says, I think I want to go to an art school. And she says, oh yeah, there's an art school in Paris. I know that. I've done that school. So it was just luck, but also surprise. And she prepared me for the exam, because it was an exam to enter there.
And that talks about not only influencers, but mentors too, right?
Yeah.
And the value of mentors kind of steering you in a direction.
Having that all the way during your career, I mean, I was lucky when I mentioned that to my teacher, that she said, hey, yeah, I know that's cool. I mean, I've done that school. You know, I know exactly. So I know exactly, you know, how to prepare you, which was actually a little bit kind of outdated. Mm-hmm. You know, it was still valid, but it was very outdated. When I got to school, I was like, scare shit. It's like, oh my God, it's like, what am I doing in here? Because she had taught me to draw in a very specific way that's very old fashioned.
Right.
By drawing volumes just by line drawings, right, with thickness of lines to imply lights and shades, which I thought was cool. But none of the students at the exam were using that.
So
they were using charcoals and hard black, white, grays. And I was like, I'm done. I'm cooked. I'm never going to get into that school. Because I thought, you know, I was totally on the sidelines, and I got in. So.
And you said on this particular piece, it's not necessarily the content of the piece that stuck with you, but the detail that the artist put in.
Yeah, well, to backtrack a little bit, when I got into the art school, then it was a whole different world. Then suddenly I was in Paris, I was among artists all around me, school of 800 people, and I was totally in my element. And these are the years where heavy metal started, you know, and that also changed the entire comic book industry. I mean, not only in France, but worldwide. I mean, the four guys were were creating that magazine, just introduced something that was never seen before in terms of storytelling, in terms of the graphic that was presented, in terms of page break, and I mean, it was just mind-changing. And so I was in art school when it happened, and that totally changed me. You know, so from already being influenced by artists like Bernie Wrightson's and Kirby and Buscema and stuff, suddenly, you know, I saw that guy Mobius, and then everything changed. So all my superheroes were starting to wear his big long hats and having these weird costumes and riding these kind of bizarre creatures. But that's part of a process, you know, and that was definitely very influential. I think that's still with me, you know, even as of today.
Now, Mobius was for those of you who don't know, a very famous French artist who kind of, his work was absolutely incredible. It changed the landscape for a lot of people in heavy metal. You know, he teamed up with the guys at heavy metal.
Yeah.
But Blueberry was kind of one of his really world-renowned works, right?
Yeah, that's how he was famous at the time. He started that Western, and it was one of the best Western ever drawn. And as every artist, and especially him in particular, I mean, he needed to change and evolve and find different things to say. And heavy metal happens, and he went into the science fiction fantasy realm and offered, you know, Arzak and all the stuff that came after that, and became Mobius.
Right.
And that was just the, you know, a shift, you know, in the industry, and everybody kind of follow suit on that. I mean, he influenced an entire generation.
And you mentioned Frank Frazetta earlier.
Oh, yeah.
What was it about Frank's work that kind of influenced you or stuck with you?
You know, it's interesting. I have a question, you know, a lot with friends, because it's not like, I mean, there's a power. I think there's a raw power to the way he painted characters that's so, I don't know, it just touched people in ways no other artists that were doing fantasy and even things that were kind of similar did. And I think it's just the power of the simplicity, but also the power in the brush strokes and the poses that he introduced that was so over, you know, the top, and it just resonated. I mean, I think it resonated with a lot of people. And, you know, it's just, you cannot avoid that artist. I mean, it was just, you know, impossible. I mean, he was there, and it's like Mobius, you know, it's like right. One of his force of design that, as an artist and painter that you just could not know.
Now, what's interesting is, while Frank was an influence to you, you're an influence to some of these people out there. Wow. And so it seems like it gets passed down, but it's the work that resonates. So we call this section After Heavy Metal. So
yeah, it's you know, it's once you're in art school and you start drinking left and right, all these influences. And I'm talking about influences, not
sure.
Yes,
okay.
You know, I'm talking about yes. Oh, there's enough problem right now with that stuff. Yes, so. But yeah, so you know, you just take it all, you know, and then you discover things you've never seen before. I mean, I was never exposed to even art and history until I went to art school. Started
right.
to discover about all these old masters, you know, that had no idea existed from, you know, times immemorial. So it's like then you get into that and then you get to learn, you know, and then obviously when you learn you pick some that you like more than others, and they become part of the stuff you gravitate around, that you want to imitate, you want to emulate, and they become part of your growing process.
And this, I think, John Berkey was definitely an influence, especially now. I see, as we go through his work, you're going to see this kind of influence, and I think it does. Some of your influences stick in the back of your mind or your subconscious, and you pull on them.
Yeah, that's
right,
true.
When you need to.
Yeah, that is true. Yeah, it's Berkey in particular, because he was one of the last I was exposed to when I was in the U.S. And he'd been around for a while, and I still didn't know that, guys. But that goes to show that there is always someone out there that you had no idea was already there for a while that you have to discover, you know. So that's kind of the excitement.
All right, so we're going to start off. You started your career, you were in art school, and then you had an opportunity to get into animation.
Yeah,
so talk a little bit about how that happened.
That was funny. I was totally unprepared. I mean, like a lot of things in life, you know, it's like you think you go there, you think you know what you're going to be doing, and then everything changes and it's never what you thought it would be. And so when I went to art school, first of all, I didn't know I was going to art school. Then when I went to art school and I was in there, I thought I would become a comic book artist because my universe was all about comic books. But then animation happened. And I think it happened because at the end of art school, as a student, like many students, you've learned something, but you don't necessarily feel very prepared. And so I was very unsure and unclear if I wanted to jump into a professional life, going after a job. I had no tools to really understand and know how to do that. So I felt very unsafe about going there. I was about 18 years old. And so someone says, hey, there's that animation school, you know, you want to do 2 more years and specialize in that? And I says, well, I don't know much. I mean, I grew up with Bambi, but doing it was something different. So I did the same thing like I did with art school. I went there, I did the exam, and I got in. But in my mind, I was doing it because I thought that was the closest things to comic books, in my mind, that would keep me in that universe safer for another couple of years before I start deciding to be serious and make a living somewhere. And that just became the launch of my career without really knowing it. It's just one of these things where you're not prepared, and then an opportunity comes in, and I was on the end of the first year where I needed to pay for the second year, and one thing led to another. I couldn't get a job anywhere, and then a friend of mine who was my neighbor was talking to this company that was doing animation in Japan because he was selling them fax machines, and he says, hey, I know some people there, let me make a phone call. And next thing you know, I'm in Japan and I'm doing stuff for Inspector Gadget, and I had no idea what it was. You know, and I had never left my country, and I had no idea what I was going to be exposed to, and I never came back.
How old were you?
I was 19.
So 19 years old, yeah. You didn't think you were going to get into animation, and then the guy goes, hey, I know some dudes.
Yeah.
And now you're in Japan.
That's right.
So talk a little bit about that process, because you said you were there, and they said, okay, we're going to have you for a month. Right?
Yeah, you know, it's when you're 18, 19, it's like many things are very unclear. You know, and it's funny because in retrospect, you know, I'm thinking, well, it should be, right? I mean, it's like, especially if you've been doing all this stuff. But no, I mean, it's like you don't know. And I didn't know. And so I was just going one day at a time, and I was just grabbing opportunities where really thinking much about where would I see myself 5, 10, 15 years down the line? What kind of professional would I be? I was just so much into my comic things and thinking, I'm at school, I'm going to finish my school years in animation, everything's going to be fine, and we'll see what happens, right? I was just not trying to get prepared for anything. So, you know, you get there, and yes, I got there, and I was to pay for my student fee for the next year of animation, and then 1 month after another, they kept saying, oh, we'd like to keep you another month, can you stay? Another month, and then at the end of the day, it says, we'd like to keep you full time, would you like to stay? You know, and even then, I was not prepared. I mean, I still thought I had to go back to France to finish school, where these guys were already giving me a job, launching my career, and I was like, I don't know about that. Let me talk to my school, because I don't want to miss the day of school. I mean, that's how goofy you could be, right? And I'm calling school, and I says, I think I need to come back to finish my second year. And the director says, no, you don't have a seat anymore, because we gave it away. And because he knew exactly what was going on. He says, why do you want to come back? I mean, to try for us to give you a job that doesn't exist because there's no industry in France when you already have it and you've already done it for 6 months? So I said, no, you take the job and you learn everything you can. And when you come back, you come to school and then you show your students and your friends what you've learned. That's valuable to me. And so, boom, I got pushed into that without thinking much about it. And in retrospect, I mean, that was the right thing to do. Kick in the butt and it's like, get in and do it.
Well, and I want to talk about that because earlier Stephan and I had a conversation about his journey in Japan, and at some point you set a goal for yourself that you wanted to be a director, right? And talk a little bit about what it was like developing your skills in Japan and how that kind of director position ultimately came about.
Yeah, director was really tied to me loving comic books and the idea of storytelling in comic books. I mean, I was always drawing. It was just not, comic books to me when I was doing it and I was practicing it and stuff was not just about drawing pretty stuff. It was really about telling stories. And so when I got into animation, I realized that was the beginning of my career and I was not necessarily going to go back to comic books, at least right away. But I was trying to kind of, okay, where would I fit in the animation industry? Because I'm already doing concept for Inspector Gadget and other shows like that, so it's fun. But I want to tell a story, and I would do that. So I started to talk to the people around me and says, okay, so what's the pathway to become a director? And they told me, you know, do this, do that, that, and keep with us, and at some point, you know, we'll train you and we'll teach you the rope and all that stuff. So, you know, that's pretty much how it happened. The interesting thing is that at the time in France, there was no industry, so everything was really happening in Japan and US. The company I was working for in Inspector Gadget, because of Gadget, they changed the TV industry, introduced something at a much different quality level and a cheaper price, which kind of was a game changer for a lot of people. So I got thrown into moving to Los Angeles when the company opened the branch there and being exposed to all that stuff. I mean, it's like all these different series that were coming in from toy manufacturers and the networks that wanted, because now there was a way to kind of produce more. So I was in the middle of that. But because I was still traveling back and forth with Japan, I was missing opportunities that were really happening in the States and not in Japan. And I realized very quickly that I could never become a director in Japan because the pathway is extremely complicated. And being a foreigner was even more difficult for me to kind of carve a path and become a director. And so I decided to move back to the States and make that happen in the States, you know, and kind of push my way in some ways to kind of get there, as that was, you know, the battleground there. And so, you know, you gotta fight for it.
And you spoke earlier to me that it was the process in Japan that really gave you the discipline and being extremely structured in your process that when you ultimately moved back to the United States, you took that experience and really helped some of the American companies do animation.
That's true. Yeah, the Japanese have a way to do their animation that's very, very efficient. Very efficient. I mean, I've learned that when I was there because I was in the middle of the whole team, both on gadgets and other shows that I work with them. And on the flip side of that, when I was coming back to the States, everything was a mess. I mean, not that I didn't know, but because it was such a was such an explosion at the time when gadget changed the industry, that company was not prepared to become such a big thing so fast. And so things were happening all over the place, and it was a mess. It was a mess. You know, people were leaving and coming in, and everybody went in, and everybody wants out, and nobody. But in Japan, they had that system down to a T for already a long time. So I was there learning exactly how you put together a design package, how you bring that design package into a pipeline, exactly how you have to do it for a Japanese pipeline system, which was very important because everything that was done in the States at the time was sent to Japan for production. So all pre-production package were done in the States, production in Japan, post-production come back to the States. But I was one of the very few that was there doing the production pipeline in Japan to understand what these guys needed from a pre-production aspect done in LA. Right. And so when I came back and I got into being a director, I knew exactly how to make that happen, which was not only a big time saver, but also financially, you know, very viable because you save time, you save money. So that just helped me in that process. And that was a good learning experience.
And we're kind of looking at, so I've been flipping through some of your designs here, and which, of course, animation then propelled you forward into storyboards. Right?
I mean, it's comic book in some ways. I mean, it's even if I never ended up doing it and became a comic book artist, always stayed with me in the idea that I always wanted to tell stories, you know, in my work, whether it's for storyboards, whether it's for animation, whether it's even now the way I approach a painting. You know, an image, you know, or how I even do a concept. It's always tied to a narrative that's always present in my mind that has to be there. And in some ways, it's super helpful, you know. So I realized that over the years that, you know, an image can be very beautiful, anything can be very well done, but there's a narrative behind that's extremely important for the structure, and when you understand that, you do it well. Then that makes that image or anything else, you know, that's artistic, you know, much more powerful. That's a good thing to kind of learn. Yeah.
And it also helps you, I think, in terms of when you get onto projects, helping you understand the scenes and the context for what you're designing for as a concept artist.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, it does. It does. It's you know, it's interesting too because every aspect of the industry is different. I mean, working in animation with animation directors, it's a very different pipeline. It's a different process than how you work in film, and how you work in theme parks, or even the publishing. So me, I've kind of always been willing to kind of jump from one field to another because I was always very curious and kind of apply, you know, these different types of narrative to different means and different projects. And that always kept me going to want to kind of learn and adapt to that.
And that seems to be a recurring theme as, you know, you and I have talked about your history, is being open and being flexible, right?
Yeah.
You kind of said you are curious, which ultimately, that kind of got you into games, right? Talk a little bit about how that transition happened.
The game was interesting because as I was already in the industry, I was already doing a lot of theme parks, I was just starting to do some films, and I was still doing animation, because animation was always part here and there, was always staying with me. The game was happening sideways to all that, but was never really there to be part of it, because at the beginning, there was Donkey Kongs and Mario Brothers, and it was very simplistic. So artistically, there's nothing for me that told me, yeah, I could be a concept artist, you know, game industry. There was nothing visually that was really telling me that would be possible.
Right.
Then Cyan happened, and the guys who did Myst. And Myst in itself was not really a game changer for me, because even Myst as it was, even if it changed the game industry, because they were the first one to bring something very interesting and different, the graphic was still not there.
Right.
It was just very good, it was better than anything else, but it was still there. That was Riven that changed all that.
Right.
When I saw Riven, I said, oh my God, this is happening. the graphics now are becoming an important part of how you could create a game. And interestingly enough, that's at the time I was approached by a company, Oddworld, to art direct a project they were working on called Abe's Odyssey.
Right.
And I had a friend who was art director while he was leaving, and he says, would you like to come and join the team? And I did not take the job because, to me, artistically, as much as the creative process before the game happened was extremely complex and beautiful, the end product was still not there to me artistically to say, wow, I could see what I'm doing being realized and feel, you know, really excited about that. And I was just right before Riven happened, and when these guys called and they were looking for a director, and I saw the end result, because that was really the key for me, I says, I want to work with these guys.
Right.
And it just happened that they were looking for someone, and we connected, and we had really tight connections, and for 5 years I ended up working with these guys. You know, bringing all the experience I had already acquired in film, you know, the narrative and the other project I had worked on, because it's exactly what they were looking for, because the game industry was changing, and they were thinking about experience that would be more cinematic and more immersive. And so they were looking for people that were less technical, which was what primarily the game industry was at the time, but more artistic, with a different thinking visually. And I felt right there at the right time, and I was just a perfect luck, you know, and just took it and started working with these guys nonstop, doing all this crazy stuff.
Now, when you and I were putting together this presentation, I think some people say, well, where do you get your ideas, right? And I asked you about this piece in particular because this piece spoke to me in terms of, you know, a stairway on a sphere, and it seems to make no sense. So talk a little bit about the direction and how you kind of came up with this again.
Yeah, it does make no sense, really. Yeah. but that was the point of it, right?
Okay. Right.
So, I mean, if you guys are familiar with the Myst universe, I mean, it's kind of mystery solving problems. You are in an environment you don't understand, and you have to find clues to understand where you are, and then progress with that to understand, you know, the story that's being told to you, and to get to the end of it. You know, it's kind of classic kind of journey. And in particular, in Myst, you have all these different portals that sends you to different worlds. And in that world in particular, that was the home of a magician,
right?
A renegade magician who just took over a planet, creating a crazy world there, and you just thrown into that. And of course, you have no idea. And everything felt bizarre, so it was very surrealist in nature. You enter these bizarre environments and houses that you think are familiar, and you're thrown into something that just doesn't make any sense.
Right.
But it doesn't make any sense at first, and then you have to find a clue that's just going to make that make sense.
Yeah.
You know, so that's part of the process. So, you know, you draw on all the stuff about, you know, what you've learned and try to create something, you know, that works with a project.
Now, some of your work is very sketchy and kind of, you know, just kind of a quick sketch that I think to give people kind of an idea, but you said some of these things never happen. Right, you'll get calls from clients and they want to kind of move forward, and we're going to see some examples of some work that you've done that just kind of doesn't come into reality.
Yeah, it's something that you learn artistically that you have to live with, you know, and that's part of the industry. You don't necessarily know that at the beginning, because when I was doing animation, everything was being realized and it's done, so
sure.
You always think everything is easy. But no, it's like a lot of things in the industry, where you work in films and theme parks, even animation. I mean, there's a lot of projects where you put your heart and soul and you really believe in it, and suddenly they just canned it for whatever reason, whether it's a financial reason, whether it's political, economical. I mean, you just don't control that, you know, which is an interesting aspect of being an illustrator, an artist in that field, is that you realize that you are a tool of a bigger, much bigger industry, that you provide something, but you are not it. And so you have to be very aware that, you know, whether you work on your own or whether you work as a team, you work for a bigger project than just what you're doing. And so yes, you adapt to a lot of, you know, compromise, and things happen sometimes where they don't happen. And you have to go with it, you know.
And we're just kind of going through some of these initial sketches, but I think some of this also, now talk a little bit about Stranglehold.
Stranglehold, Thermal was interesting because that was the first project I was ever offered, and I was right after Cyan, doing all mist things. And these guys called me, and it's interesting, they couldn't care much about the work that I did on mist and all this stuff, not even care about the stuff that I was doing as a science fiction or a fantasy artist. But what they're interested in is the narrative aspect of the work that I had done all these years. And they knew I had worked on film. Mm-hmm. And I was important to them too, because Stranglehold was based on a John Woo film from Hong Kong. And the company had decided to kind of team up with the director, John Woo, to create a game based on one of his first films. And so for them, that was also important because they had never done that as a company, and they were looking for someone who had a cinematic understanding, you know, of a project, not just being a good artist, but also was very clear and had a mind about storytelling and stuff like that. And they saw that in the work that I did, because I had done some storyboard work on film and stuff, and they said, so we're kind of looking for someone like that. But the project itself, it kind of took me by surprise, because I thought I'd be doing sci-fi and fantasy and stuff, which is what I was kind of good at. And so it forced me to kind of think outside of a box on how you take an environment and a project that's just dealing with, you know, Chicago or Hong Kong, you know, it's just an environment that's very familiar, but make it super exciting, because that's the goal. You have to create an exciting experience. And it's not just anymore about the gameplay, because the gameplay drives the game, but you know, one of the reasons I was hired is because the visual was becoming an important part of the pipeline, and Midway, on top of that, had never experienced throwing so much emphasis on visual, because they were a very technical game company. And so they actually were very open to any kind of ideas and suggestions, even before they hired me. They wanted to understand who I was and how I would approach a project like that if I was ever interested to work with these guys. And so I started thinking film. I started thinking about how, if that was a film, how I would approach that thing. And that brought me to a film that I always love for its visual, is Black Rain, right? You know, from Ridley Scott. Because to me, that was a very good example about how you turn an environment that's somehow very familiar and turn it into a visual experience. Right. Graphically, it's just beautiful. And I said, I think that's how I would approach that game, mm-hmm. you know, from that angle, you know. And they loved that. They said, well, okay, so you're in. So show us how we could make that happen. And so that also gave me the opportunity, which was unique at the time in the industry, to show the company a whole new pipeline of design and concept that is as important and drives a project, as opposed to be driven by a technical aspect of it and the gameplay aspect of it. So I was given a lot of flexibility and work with different teams to try to teach that industry how visual can become a really, really important part of a pipeline processing game, and not just be a tool on the side and then the gameplay and then the post and all that stuff, but everything thought of as an integral part of the project. And that was very exciting, you know, and that project was what it is at the end, because again, like I mentioned earlier, you know, you don't control the economy aspect of it, and so, you know, we're in the middle of getting new engines, new platforms that were just promised to us with a particular type of technology and power that we never got at the end. So the game just kind of finished itself in the best shape it could, but it could have been so much more. But again, you live with, you know, you just say, well, I did the best I could.
And so you jumped into Area 51, right?
Yes, because after that experience at Midway, even if the game was never at the level of the expectation that we thought it would be because of all the promises from a technology standpoint, the company understood that what I had proposed and show them as a pipeline from a concept standpoint was extremely relevant to the industry. Because right. I also show them not only how it was relevant from a visual and a narrative standpoint to create an immersive experience in game, but it saved an enormous amount of money. Mm-hmm. Because by being prepared, since I had already learned from Japan about how you prepare a package to be ahead of the curve, so that you're not trying to catch up with the technology that's waiting for you, I forced on the company to create a team that was there 6 months ready prior to anything else that was being thrown out. And I showed them also how all the work that was created was always on the wall, always every day, which is very film-like in terms of way of process. so that everybody walking every day could get excited because they see stuff. And so, and I wanted the whole process to be exciting. I wanted to work with the designers to understand what we brought to the table, because that was also a scary experience for a lot of people to suddenly see an artist that comes from a different background just step in, like it's an elephant in a porcelain shop, and says, whoa, wait a minute. It's like, you know, we're doing the gameplay here. You know, it's like game is a good gameplay, and say, yeah, it is. But it's also about a different experience that you can have if you're willing to kind of embrace it and look at it from a total package. And that was what I brought to the game industry. I didn't even know but at the time I was doing that, because I was just doing it naturally. Because I came from having done it in film, and the thinking process was already obvious to me from comic books and stuff. I just brought something that just made sense. And the industry totally saw it and said yes. So they put me in charge of the entire kind of concept development for the entire company worldwide. So I got to become a service within the company, wow, with my own group of people providing concept and visual and trying to sell them, which was actually a nightmare for me, because now I became a manager, which is not what I wanted to become, but I was forced into management and knocking on doors on every project and says, hey, this is what we do, and you know, give us some work and we could do this for you, and so, you know, I just hated that.
You're describing a lot of UX scenarios right now.
Yeah, well.
So yeah, and for the UX folks in the room, doesn't that sound a lot like the advice they're giving us is put it up on the wall, right? And designers show our teams what we're doing and where we want to go. And of course, I'm going to kind of, we've got a lot of slides still to go, but you know, some of these projects, you know, in the DC universe, you've kind of been pulled into a lot of the DC universe, right?
Well, that was for Mortal Kombat. So that was also a big thing at Midway, but that was an entity on its own. It was very interesting that they operated differently from the rest of the company because they had a product that was so successful. But I ended up at the end working with them because they also were embracing the new technology and they wanted to do something that was just visually kick-ass. It says, we need something that's going to be different because now we have, you know, an engine that can
do handle it.
So help us out, you know. So I jumped on that, you know, like I jumped on many other games for the company before I left, you know, which eventually led me to work for Rage.
Right.
And Rage was actually a very interesting experience because that was the company that finally was able to put out the quality, the output quality of everything that you could put in as an artist.
Right.
Because it's always the struggle in the game industry, that's like you could create a pre-production package that is as beautiful as can be, but the end product is always the challenge because the technology, the limitations, you know, the gameplay and a whole bunch of other stuff. So it's never ever to the level of a film, for example.
Right.
When I work on film, I know they're going to do it right. It's more a matter of, is your stuff going to get in, you
right.
know, if they don't discard it. But you know, film has the quality because they've been around forever, the same thing as animation. You know, what you do is what you see, because it's an art project. But game, it's still evolving, you know, and at the time I was doing that, you know, it's still that struggle of the difference between the artistic package you put out and then the end result. Rage was different because they had figured out the quality issues before the game was even started.
Right.
Because Carmack was very keen on wanting to do something visually striking. And so he built an engine, making sure that before we even get into full productions to realize the concept and stuff, he could make it work technically. That was going to be running at 60 frames a second, which was actually very challenging visually, and make sure that that was working before we even get to the next chapter. So when I got in the company, he says, finally, a company that can do something awesome. And the universe was just totally my cup of tea. I mean, it's like, you know, post-apocalyptic stuff, sci-fi, I mean, it was just all. So that was an
exciting. So talk about your 3D work, because you started to do some 3D work here, right?
Yes, Rachel allowed me many interesting things, you know, and it's interesting because it's always part of a, you know, I always, every time you shift gear, and Rage was a time where I needed to shift gears, you know, you're always struggling with being relevant. You know, and keep up, you know, with the technology, keep up with the competitions, artistically, who you are as an artist and art directors, and push the envelope so that you're always on top of your game. That's part of the process. It's very difficult. And so I know when I got into Rage, there's still a lot of things I didn't know. You know, I was starting to play a little bit with 3D, but it was not my thing. And I know 3D was becoming more and more important in the industry in terms of a tool that you use to help you, as well as understand more aspect of it, the technical aspect of a game, to get more entrenched in terms of how you can integrate the concept into the technology, you know, better. And Rage gave me that opportunity. You know, it's like, and I've kind of jumped in saying, if this is the game I have to do it, I have to do it now. So I have to jump into 3D, I have to really get into it. And I was talking to some of the guys there and starting to learn, you know, more stuff and trying to get more comfortable with it. And something happened also that was extremely important on that game, is I was able, which I had never done before, but being able to put myself as a visual artist inside the engine. And that was a very interesting experience, because now you could see what the world that is going to be created is in terms of real space. And you could approach a concept now from a three-dimensional point of view, which I had never done before. I always approached my concept from a beautiful image that sets up the tone for a scene or a whole sequence, or just, you know, get people excited, never from in-game, you know, tool. And so by being able to drop myself into the engine, into the game stuff, then I could start thinking about, okay, how am I going to compose my scene visually so that it could look cool from that angle, but also from here, because I know you're going to be coming from here or there or back, and make sure that every time you do that, something cool visually is being offered to the viewer. And that was a completely different experience, and much more complex too, because now you have to deal with a visual that is not just two-dimensional, but from multiple standpoint. And that was super exciting. I mean, I was spending more time inside, even just playing around. I remember I developed a scene with which didn't happen. Again, you know, it's like in things where you have to cut a DM for technology reason, where there was these huge landscape of tankers. Oh. And I wanted to kind of propose a landscape that was, instead of using rocks, which was part of the first half of the project, was getting rid of that stuff and proposing different types of occlusion objects, like giant massive things, but in that case, tankers. And then you're in a car in there. And I had realized from the first part of the project that, and I talked to some of the guys at the company too, we never had the chance to push, because you're driving cars in that environment, we never had the chance to push it, to get the car and really get to full speed, and I wanted to do that, because I like, you know, speed games in car stuff. So I kind of offered that environment where suddenly you had an open space, you could get your car and push a pedal and just go crazy, crazy and jump on things. And I was super excited, you know, and I got to drop my car every day, and I was just riding there and just even staying there just for the fun of just pushing the car, and before I even, you know, got back to the concept. And fortunately, you know, the concept was mixed, because, you know, at the end of the day, the game needed to be happening, and there was not enough space, and there was constraints and, you know, compromise we had to make, and so that whole level book slash. The concept remains, the experience remains, which is, I think, the important part of the process, but, you know, yeah, you just live with it.
And so now you're on to Fallout, right?
Yeah.
Talk about that, because in each of these experiences, you're kind of bringing what you know to bear, and you can see it in your work. You're starting to include all of these things in the way you look at your environments differently.
Yeah, yeah. Everything you learn, every step of the way, gives you a little bit more on the next project. This one was kind of interesting, because Fallout, I had finished Rage, and the company was unclear at that stage if there would be a Rage 2, if I would be continuing with the company, you know, on that project, or something else would happen. They were scrambling to try to finish things. There were issues on other sides too, so nobody was kind of clear. So I used the time that was left, you know, after the Rage project, because the team was really kind of on its own finishing that. There was never a need for me to be really every day single there and follow the process. So I got a phone call from the guys in Bethesda, who was also, you know, owning id Software, their partners and stuff, and they said, you know, well, we have you here, you know, just help us and just do this kind of crazy environment, just and give us some ideas about, you know, what we could be doing for Fallout 4. And, you know, for about a few months, kind of worked on that, and it was fun, you know, so.
So, and you and I talked earlier about how long do these things take, because a lot of the students, some of them are having portfolio reviews. So, an image like this, how long would you spend on that back at that time?
Oh, about 2 or 3 years.
Yes, sir. Not no, it's very slow, very slow. No, it's...
yeah, it's a lot of money for one.
So no, but something like, I mean, this one should, like this one was a big piece. I would say at least a good week and a half, you know. And it's really hard for me to judge even what that means, you know.
Right.
It's like, because when you're in a pipeline, you just do it automatically, you know, and something like this could take me a few days, even less, you know, because
right.
It's good composition, it's simple, it's just about an idea that's very direct, you know, but it's not crazy in terms of its perspective. It's just about a mood piece that just conveys an idea. The one before that is extremely complex because now you want to convey 10 different ideas in an entire space, you know, with what could be happening in there. So each image is its own thing, you know, so you just know that when you work on a project, you usually tell you, well, we want so many images per week, or this is the schedule for delivery and we need so many, and so you learn to adapt to these needs. On Fallout, actually, I was lucky because there was not really a deadline.
Right.
There was Blue Sky Project. It's ideas we developed, we think about it, we're just having fun. That's
right.
It's a kickstart of the project to excite everyone. That's the best situation to be because now you're not under constraints and you could do fun stuff. You can explore and create stuff that you don't necessarily have the time when you're working in films in the middle of productions and you got 2 days to do a painting and you got to keep on going and nobody cares if the painting looks good because they're trying to convey an idea quickly to the producers to get the funding to move forward. So it's a different process.
Which I kind of move forward to present day, and my clicker again is having fun with me. But so we'll have, it's games, let's go back to games in present day. And you and I talk about this, you can really see the evolution in your models, right?
Yeah.
In the sense of design as you're coming up for these structures. Talk a little bit about that, because it seems like you started to have a little more fun and your designs had a little more organic nature. Was that part of the game, or was that just you being Blue Sky? How much did you stick to the constraints of the game, and how much was your input?
This project, when they contacted me, they already knew me and they knew what I did.
Mm-hmm.
So they had seen a lot of work. I mean, that project was, I think, launched last year, so it's fairly recent. So they already had a whole bunch of my work and says, this is what you did, which is what we would like to build that world to look like.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and it included everything that's very technical, very organic in terms of architectures and stuff like that, which was part of some of the paintings I'd done. So I mean, I had been all over the place. What was interesting about that game is, yes, everything needed to be modular. There was limitation because it's like a SimCity type game. So you build a world, so you start populating an entire space with little things, buildings and what have you. And so the challenge here was to find out, to create elements that would be cool, but also very efficient. That would not be impossible to build because they're too complex and you can only afford a few as opposed to a few hundred that you need to populate the area. So that kind of got me to think about, you know, efficiency, you know, and then 3D came very handy at that time. I mean, that's one thing, you know, what I love about the process is, you know, you start something as an artist and you take a chance. Like learning 3D, that's a gamble. I mean, that's an investment. You know, you don't know if it's going to pay off. I mean, you get a sense that it's important, that could be very useful to you, but you take a chance without knowing really, you know, where it's going to lead. And then boom, suddenly the next project presents itself and says, ah, that's it. Now I can use that skill. And so there's always a time when it becomes relevant, which is, kind of always tells me, you know, never stop learning, because
right.
Everything could not maybe mean something at the time you're doing it, and you invest, and you says, well, I'm just learning, but I'm not making any money, or I'm not, you know, doing something, you know, but then eventually that kind of pays off. And so it's always something good to remember, you know, it's like nothing is being wasted, you know, and that's the kind of lesson I kind of learned,
mm-hmm.
you know, about all the different things I had to adapt and jump into. I mean, Photoshop is, you know, we didn't talk about it earlier, but Photoshop was also a big game changer.
Yeah.
You know, and that's something I knew that I needed to do when it happened. And that totally changed the industry, and I knew I had to go there. I needed to, because you have to be relevant.
Now, when we were going through this deck, this piece really resonated with me, especially how you captured the energy of the scene and the water, and it just, in my opinion, you achieved that kind of master level in terms of this. Can you talk a little bit about this project? Because I thought the story was interesting.
Well, that's interesting, yeah. You know, it's so, when I think back, it's always funny how things come back. And they make sense, years after years. And this was a storyboard, but the way they wanted to do it, they wanted to turn it into an animatic, and they wanted a storyboard that was done extremely realistic, photorealistic. So my friend called me and says, I got that project, and obviously you know how to use Photoshop, so this is perfect for you. And so I was kind of combining everything that's storytelling, and then storyboard, and all the detail and the energy and the skill that you could put as an artist into an image, and the technical aspect of creating that image to break it down properly so that they can animate, so it has all the layers, then it's like a film process almost, you know. And so everything kind of came together, you know. And this image was extremely complex. I mean, we had like three months, and we had to crank real fast, and that's when all the Photoshop stuff, you know, that comes back to you, and all the technique and being efficient and finding ways that make sense, you know. So it was pleasant, because I tend to work when I want to be in a comfort zone, because that's how I think I produce the best of my work. But in some ways, that's not true. I tend to produce the best when I'm under pressure. It's weird, you know, but it's like if you give me something to do and you don't give me a guideline to start, like a film script or whatever, I could spin my wheel for hours. Because I say, well, I could do this, I could do that, I could do that. And stuff that says, oh, no, I could do. So it's like having somehow a direct goal or a pipeline or a track to follow kind of just gets me going very fast. And when you have pressure, then suddenly your brain goes real fast and says, okay, you don't have much time, but you have to be super efficient. So you don't play around with possibilities, you just do it, clack, 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 and you hope it works,
right?
You know, and sometimes it doesn't. I mean, it's not like everything is perfect.
There's a couple things that, as you were talking, one, I meant to mention earlier, the great guys at Spacey, did you guys check out the experience outside while you were coming in from Spacey? And Stephan worked with Spacey, because that's Stephan's art, so if you didn't have a chance to go by the Spacey booth, please go by. But notice as you move around, you're starting to work with technology companies that you're incorporating this design and saying, how do we pull it into more interesting, interactive experience?
Yeah, that's exciting, especially with what's going on right now with VR, you know, and AR, and all these different things like Spacey, you know, it's like interactive touch projection mapping and stuff like that. I mean, that is exciting, because artistically, it's almost like I'm seeing another window into a whole new chapter of what you could do as an artist with a technology that's just starting to happen. It's exciting to me because I've experienced it when I first jumped into animation, and animation, you know, kind of exploded in terms of TV stuff. And then boom, I experienced that when I got into the game industry, and it exploded, and I was right there to help that process. And now I'm kind of seeing that happening with that technology and the potential. But also, it's kind of scary too, because how am I going to adapt to that? Because it's like, what is the artist of tomorrow going to need to be relevant with this type of technology? And that's the big question. And so then again, it's like, okay, I got to learn something here. I got to figure out how that works.
Well, if there's anybody, I'm not worried about you. But I do think it was also good, before we jump into the film section here really quick, a lot of you are wondering, and some of you are going through portfolio reviews, what do I do, right? Because the possibilities are endless in what you put in your portfolio. Sometimes I think what you may have to do is put some constraints on yourself, right? Put yourself under pressure as if you had a real client and they asked you to do this thing, because that might inspire you to get your stuff done just like Stephan does. Because I think when the world is open and you can do anything, it's hard to focus in.
Yeah.
And sometimes you have to give yourself that constraint.
Yeah, that's true.
Stay on
and it's path. Becoming a very competitive industry. I mean, you know, I wouldn't say I was lucky, but I grew up where the internet didn't exist, cell phone didn't exist. So you had to go the traditional way of, you know, handing up your portfolio and just knocking on doors to talk to people. You had no way of showing work anywhere because there was no internet. So it was kind of a hard process, and you had to be in the right place at the right time and then get lucky. Like right. I was in France studying animation. It's my neighbor next door. I was not even an artist who says, hey, I got a gig for you. I mean, so, but the internet changed all that. I mean, now everyone can have a kick-ass portfolio online and then reach out people. You can find out what's going on out there everywhere. And it's just open, you know. But then, at the same time, now the competition is very fierce because the tools are there now. Not only just the information, but the learning tools are out there on how to, because now artists like myself all over the place, they are giving what they've learned, and you can learn from these guys.
Right.
You know, and so that created a whole new generation of concept artists and artists who want to get into a different entertainment field, but that makes it also very difficult because the industry is not necessarily growing at the same rate as
right.
people want to get
There's
in.
The number of people who want to get in.
So, yeah.
What's, now, you're starting to do more costumes, right?
Well, costume, yeah. You know, it's a funny thing. And again, you know, be ready and be surprised because you never expected. I was working on Suicide Squad, and I was working with my friend Oliver, and I thought I would be doing environments like I usually do. And then one of a sudden he says, well, we get this costume rig, this main character stuff, you know, what, do you want to give it a shot? You know, and I can do costumes, so I say yes. So I was still part of that concept pipeline. And suddenly I get a phone call and he says, well, you're going to be working with that person now, continuing the costume stuff. And I said, well, what's going on? What I mean, it's not concept anymore. It says, no, you're going to kind of shift your costume because there's, well, there's, you know, we're working things out in the studio. So, because there's something happening in the film industry that's interesting, is like, since these big blockbusters are happening with superheroes like, you know, Iron Man's and Batman's and the vehicles, the costumes are now, the question is it still part of a costume department or is it part of a concept department? But in the film industry, it's very separate.
Right.
But this kind of blurs the line.
Right.
Is it a costume or is it a concept? And so they're trying to figure that out. And in that particular instance, it says, well, you know, work with her. She's the costume designer. And you guys, you know, do some stuff. And because of that, you know, that got me to work on Aquaman.
Right.
And I was totally unprepared because when they called me on Aquaman, I thought I was going to be doing concept stuff like usual. And she said, no, I'm a costume designer. I want you to do costume for the film. All right. And I said, well, okay. So, and then
you're
I got
to pay me? Okay.
I mean, it's conceptual, but it's another aspect of the industry I was totally unprepared for, and
right.
it just came in like this, and I said, all right, well, let's do it. Let's embrace it. So, you know, that's one thing. And it goes to say that it's always a good thing, in some ways, artistically, to be ready for things like that. And it's always an interesting debate about, okay, should I be good at one thing as an artist? Should I concentrate on people designs or environments and do something like that? Or should I be prepared for many things? I don't think there is really to me personally, I would say, do everything. But be good at everything the same way. Don't be weak in one area and good at rest. Like if you want to do custom design environments, vehicle designs, anyone do cartoons, anyone do realistic stuff, make sure that you're good at everything. So that you are relevant in every aspect of this process. If you're not, then yeah, then concentrate on what you're really good at because that's what people, you know, are going to be wanting you for and paying you for. And some people are very good at one thing and that's all they do and they're excellent.
Right.
You know, so it's an interesting thing too.
That's that generalist versus specialist debate where,
yeah.
you know, what do I do? But I think to your point, and I'll just add my two cents in there is, in your career, you picked one thing at a time and you got really, really, really good at it. And then you built on these other aspects of your career as the opportunity presented itself. And then you just focused down and got really good, right?
Yeah.
So it's that work ethic, right? In terms of getting good at the thing
yeah.
that was in front
yes.
of you.
Yeah, that's true. You know, it's also about,
You know, it's insane because it's a question I never even asked myself when I started, but I ask people now all the time, because that's always a very good guideline, is when someone comes to me, wants to become a concept artist in whatever aspect of the industry, my question to them is like, where do you see yourself in 5 years? Just like this, it's like, if you could have what you have, or just where you see yourself 5 years, or in 10 years, and the answer could be that track that you follow. Because sometimes people, they come in and says, I want to be a concept artist, but they don't really understand what it means, or they don't have an understanding of the industry, and a different type of industry where you could be a concept artist, and things like that. So it's a general word, as a concept artist could mean many things. So I says, well, think about yourself 5 years, where you see. And if a guy says, oh, well, I'd be at Disney doing this, and then that's it. Then I know exactly what you need to concentrate on as a concept artist. So it's really, as a growth process, it's really aware of where you want to go. Right? You know, that kind of directs, at least me, in terms of the choices I made, wanting to learn 3D, wanting to learn Photoshop, so wanting to learn to be able to understand certain aspects of the game industry, the film industry, so that not only I could stay relevant because I knew it was getting more and more competitive, but also, you know, be able to constantly shift from one to the other because I like that. I just can't get stuck on one thing all the time. It's just me.
And we're still going through, I went through iRobot and, you know, Total Recall, right? I mean, you've had an opportunity to work on some of these iconic films, and again, these really amazing kind of settings that set the tone of the world that you're in, and it seems like you're asked a lot of time to do that type of concept art.
Yeah, it's never something I foresaw at the beginning. It's just because I think how I embraced and started using Photoshop, which is a very my painting type approach, you know, photographic manipulation, things like that. That got me to create very, very elaborate images. It's just because, like, that's how it felt to me, you know, as to how I wanted to use the tool. And I think because of that, that kind of resonated to a certain aspect of film, which is the beginning stages, the blue sky stages and stuff, or creating images that would be used in a very different way in a pipeline than just being there every day and churn out concepts. So images like 300 or Total Recall, that particular production designer was a good friend of mine that we worked many years on, knew exactly how it worked, and was able to know how to use that to his own advantage. So instead of having me to work 6 months every day, do quick images, you know, to get there, he had guys for that. What he wanted me to do was to create big images that I could be spending several weeks on it, but have every type of information available in that, so that he could take that image into his own pipeline and get to a special effect people and says, this is what I want. This is the type of material that I want. This is the type of light, the mood, the detail, yeah, all in one image. So instead of having me do 10 different images for a different moment of the scene, say, do one big shot and put everything in it. And I love that stuff.
Right.
You know, because that totally fit, you know, the way I wanted to work, and that just made the job easy. Not that I couldn't do quick stuff.
Sure.
But that's one aspect of things I could do that people ask of me, you know, and that made things kind of cool. That's another example too.
Yeah, this really was, until I saw Tomorrowland, I hadn't seen quite an environment or a city like this. I think you kind of inspired a lot of people after this.
I hope I did, because, you know, it's interesting, because this one was an image that was commissioned to me not by the concept department on the film, but by the advertising department at Disney. And I don't know what was going on at the time over there, but they called me in and says, oh, we need you to do a concept for a poster, which actually was never a concept for a poster, but that's how he kind of presented it to me. Sid Mead was working on it too. He had done some tech on that. And they wanted to see the city. They wanted to get a visual. But apparently, they had not found a visual for the city. And from what I could gather, they were struggling with the concept department to get images from the concept department for the promotional material to start getting the campaign going. And so instead of getting me in a concept part of that pipeline stuff, the advertising department came to me and says, give us something we could use. And that became actually something that became part of the film. But it was just one image. One image, and they took that image and extrapolated from that, which is great.
Right.
You know, but in terms of what you were saying earlier about set up something, I mean, an interesting little note is when I was working on Ready Player One, that image was brought back to me by the production designer because he says specifically, Spielberg is looking for a design for that city that's in Ready Player One, and he do not want anything like this one.
We want it to look nothing like this.
Nothing like it. Because Spielberg had a very specific idea of how he wanted, but he didn't know, but he was hoping we would kind of come up with something different. And to him, Tomorrowland was messy. He says, no, it's too messy, I want to see something different. You know, and he had pointed out to not just this one, but other cities that I had done. He says, I do not like these, but I want something different. You know, so it's like, yeah, the pressure is on big time.
Yeah.
So, but that's, you know, that's what it is.
And Guardians, you had a story about this piece, right? Where the guy that hired you, you said he had looked at your stuff and he knew that this was something in the world that you wanted to bring. And what's interesting about this is that is Stefan in an actual live version of the pod from Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah, we should get me in a movie too, because it's like, you know, you can't control that, right?
Right.
So, I mean, I tried to, but that didn't kind of work out.
But not all three.
No, but I mean, this actually is a very good example because that was a scary moment for me. Because when I started designing that pod, I had no idea about what it was going to be used in the film and that they were going to be building a real thing.
Right.
And actually. And so I started concept like I do concept usually. And suddenly, as we're getting closer and closer to a look, I started to understand that they wanted the detail because they were going to build it.
Right.
And so suddenly 3D now became very relevant.
Right.
And I was not actually entirely ready with 3D because, what I was not prepared of is like, okay, well, I'm going to use 3D with what I know, and enough for one hour. So my process of using 3D is very dirty. It's like Photoshop, you layer stuff. I don't care about a model being clean.
The vertices.
Because it's for concept purposes. I'm not handing out that models to, again, you know, a technician or something that's going to be used as is. So, you know. So I just did it. So I built enough of a model to be able to understand its shape and volume and turn it around and do all the necessary view. But then the department, the modeling department, called and says, we would like to have your model. And I said, and suddenly I'm like, why would you want to have my model? You guys are the modelers. Right? I says, yeah, but you modeled it, so it's going to time saver for us. We just want to use it. And I said, I can't give you my model, it's a piece of because, and it's difficult, I had to tell them, because when they saw that, they thought it was 3D. And I said, no, it's really, my model is very dirty, believe me, and everything else is Photoshop. I finished it and polished it, but you do not want to have my model. So I had to kind of push because I didn't want to show them also something. You know, but told me something very interesting too. And that's again where I'm trying to get more and more in 3D right now and make the effort. It's because now I know the film studio would ask a concept artist to produce a 3D model.
Right.
And it's another tool now that is now being almost obviously requested of you as a concept artist. Because well, you can do it. Wesh, great, bring it in. And then that saves some time for us. So, you know, knowing that now kind of make me work and approach my 3D models a little bit more carefully because I know I could get the request and says, hey, we need your model. So I want to give him something that's going to be useful and not just get a piece of doo-doo.
Iconic, right? You're working on the Avengers and, you know, a pivotal scene, but this scene resonated with me because I sat there and I go, that is totally Stark's workshop, right? If you saw the film, I go, boom, you nailed it. And this is one of those pictures where they wanted everything, right?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting you're saying that because I was not the only artist working on that film, and other artists had done also different versions of Alive. So I wouldn't necessarily say, well, this is it, and that's the image that was kind of influential. More than I would say, it was part of a process where many artists participated, and then it became what it is at the end, without really necessarily knowing of it. Use this, and use that as is, you know, because that's also part of a film process. You never know. You're working with other guys, and it's not necessary that you're given the assignment and you're the only one who's going to tackle it. Sometimes they could start something, and then they'll take it away from you, and they want another artist to give you their take on that, because they will get ideas. That is part of the process, and that could be very frustrating, because artistically you could say, well, I own that stuff, you know, but you don't. You know, you have to be ready to hand it out to other people who are going to put their 2 cents on it. Sometimes it's going to be discarded, sometimes they're going to keep a portion of that, and that's how it works. You know, unless you do something very specific like the pod, where I really owned it because I started it, and it made no points for other artists to jump on it. Things like these are conceptually
a collective work
because there's potential on how you could build that set.
Got it.
It makes more sense to share ideas and have different people take a shot at it and see how they would approach that, so that the production designer and director can say, I like that portion there, but I don't like this or this and that, and then you come up with the final image. That's a film process. Yeah.
So again, you're getting back to kind of Suicide Squad, the costume.
Well, that's what we talked earlier. Yes, that's what got me into working with Aquaman, doing more costumes, you know, different stuff. But at the time, you know, this is how it started.
And here we are in Ready Player One. Do you guys remember this scene? Yeah.
Yeah, you know, and it's interesting because Ready Player One, I mean, the scene I was talking to me about, the city environment, I think it's in there. Yeah. You never see it in the film. And this is a shot I spent, and not that particular painting, I must have done 12, 15 different paintings with different ideas of what in situ that's described in the book could look like. And that's where I spent pretty much all my energy with different architectural ideas of what the space could be. And at the end of the film, it's not there. Not there. You don't see it.
So much like tomorrow, then.
Well, you're totally right, because at the end of the day, you wonder, why didn't he use it? So is it a narrative issue that he didn't really kind of bring anything more to the story, and so that was not necessary to kind of bring in? Or was it just because maybe, the visual was not achieved to Spielberg's satisfaction? He says, well, I don't want to show it because I'm not fitting it with all these ideas to show something that would be original. I don't know. You know, I can only second guess that stuff. You know, I want to believe that maybe it's just the narrative and the thing was really cool, but, you know, they don't want to use it for other reasons. But, you know, that's what it is.
So, and we're getting into some of your projects you recently worked on. This is interesting on Alpha. You're again bringing the mood of the film, right?
Yeah, and that's interesting because, again, that's a project I was completely not expecting. I do science fiction, I do fantasy stuff. I mean, I could do other things, but it's not what people necessarily know me. And for some reason, that director, I worked him on Akira, and Akira never happened. But during my time working with him, I had done some key images to present the film to the studios, and he remembered one in particular that he thought was very striking and very moody, but still very sci-fi and stuff. And he came back to me when he was working on that. And just because of that image, he said, I know you could do something else, because I love the sensibility that you put in that particular painting. And so I'm working on that project, which is very, kind of, very different. You know, it's nothing sci-fi and stuff, but I want you to approach it from a photography approach, a perspective. You know, think about the mood and what these images are gonna be. It's, you know, it's caveman story, and it's beautiful, actually. The movie is beautiful. So I got me to do things that are much more matte painting thinking, and much more from almost the same way I approached Stranglehold, you know, from a photography, cinematography kind of perspective, to think more about the colors, the mood, and how to create an image that's striking, more than trying to create a concept.
Yeah.
You know, it's about design and cool shapes and stuff like that.
Yeah, I think, you know, and here we are. Talk a little bit about this. This is kind of cool.
Well, I got lucky because that's the first thing I released, and that's the thing I did. So usually I'm always the last one.
And so Spielberg cut yours, they didn't hear that.
So yeah, Aquaman is like that. These are the customer designed for it, and they release that online, and so it says, oh, it's awesome because it's the whole royal family. And I worked actually. It's interesting because to what I was talking earlier, it's like to get to that point takes months and months of iteration, of changes and different ideas and process. Where you can never really know at the end what is going to be the end product. Now, that's one kind of frustrating aspect of the film industry. It's like you give a lot in terms of ideas and energy, but at the end of the day, you don't really know until you see the film what's being really used and how much and how valuable the work that you produce was. So you go with the flow, hoping that what you do is really making a difference or helping the process. But it's a guess, So on that guess, I was very excited to see that. Everything made it, and it's pretty much as is, so it's pretty cool.
I'm hoping it's a good story.
Well, me too. That's not much, so. At least I can't take credit for this one.
All right, and Venom's coming out, right?
Yeah, it did. Yeah, Venom is coming out, and that's going to be, I don't know. Not only I don't know, but I cannot even say anything about it.
Oh, yeah, okay. I can say, I think there's been some previews.
But I did very different things in here. I did some actually, this is one thing, again, animation came back. Mm-hmm. I was asked to do some breakdown animation sequence for special effects for a certain part of the movie, which was not expected, but because they knew I could do that, says we need to get some ideas about how that thing works at some point. And then what I did also a lot on that film, which was really cool, is a lot of architecture stuff. There's a particular location in the film that required a lot of architectural thinking, and that was really exciting. So it was a lot of different design stuff. I'll put that on the website
when it's released.
Yeah, so that's fine.
And this is coming out?
It's coming out too. I mean, it's kind of a weird year, and it's exciting too, because I've never worked on film where in 1 year, three of the films I worked on are being released. It's usually 1 a year, sometimes you wait 2 years to see a film, that's pretty kind of standard. But like having three film boom, back to back, you worked on it, that's pretty cool.
I think you have a career in this, man.
I think so, it's like, it's all about believing it, it's like, and then learning, and start trying to say, okay, I need the foot in the door. But yeah, Alita was a fun project.
All right, and we're going to get to theme parks. What I think is really exciting about this, and I was just there, for those of you that are on my Facebook, right? You probably saw some of this. This was what it was like when you go on the ride. And I had never seen one of those Disney rides where you truly felt that you had gone into another world. And boy, did they do it. Talk a little bit about this project. In Animal Kingdom, they really take this part of the park and make you feel as if you're on that planet.
Avatar was really cool.
Yeah,
really cool. And this one and the Pirates of the Caribbean, because they use a similar technology of projection images into rides, which is a new thing that they're doing right now. It's happening more and more. They mix real sets and projection films to kind of enhance the experience. Avatar, it's like the Pirates, is interesting because it's something very, not only it's something conceptual that I know how to do and stuff, but it has a very different technical aspect as being part of a project. You're working with very specific set designs, constraints for safety and the way the rooms work and the ride works. So that's something I had to learn over the years in terms of being familiar. Because when I work on film, you don't have to worry about that. They're going to build it, it's all fake, it's all special effect. They make anything happen. You just sit and you enjoy it. Theme parks, you can't. Theme park, you have to be very aware of all the constraints, from every technical aspect so that you know the space you're working with and what's being necessary to show, not show, what you cannot do and all that kind of stuff. And so I work a lot with 3D models. More and more right now, theme park industry send me, blockouts of these rooms where everything is already laid out. And you work within that space to try to create the visual that's going to be exciting. you know. And so what's exciting is that all they have at the beginning is an empty space.
Right.
So they want the magic in there. So obviously on Avatar, I had all the references from the film,
sure.
So it was easy to kind of draw and pull everything from it. But what was challenging, especially when you work in theme park, it's a narrative thing. You're being pulled into a story, even if the story is very simple. What's really important is to draw the viewer to exactly where you want him to be so that they don't wander and lose focus while they're supposed to experience the ride. And that's all about compositions and all the stuff you learn over the years about how you use the visual tools, you know, to understand, you know, where you put your values, your colors, your lights, your points of interest, so that you direct the viewer as he's moving and keep him there, you know, and then you work around for things that are unnecessary. It's a whole process that's very interesting, and I kind of like that. You know, it's something that I didn't know I would really enjoy, working with very technical constraints and having limitations, you know, but that's also something that's kind of good to have as a balance to exploring free stuff, like the book covers, you know, which we're going to cover.
Now, some of these are concepts have come into play, but some of them are concepts that, you know, didn't happen.
Well, it's like the film, yeah.
Right.
You know, it's like you work on some project, you don't know, you know, you just do what you ask because, you know, it's always part of how it works. And in that case, they wanted the dragons, or that case was a big project in Dubai, and that was actually right before the big crash. And that big crash is what killed the whole thing.
Right.
But they wanted to do something huge. I mean, there was like years and years of concepting on that stuff that could have happened. And, you know, 4 or 5 months into that, it said, there's no more money. So, you know, you do good stuff, and that was great because, I mean, I got into really going back into my architecture kind of love, you know, building stuff, and you could already imagine it, and it doesn't happen.
Now, we talked about this work was for the poster, right?
Yeah. I mean, as a concept artist, I mean, when you start working in one aspect of a film, I mean, the entertainment industry, film, and then you jump back, I mean, your skill allows you to do many things. And so, you know, it's not a stretch for me to go and do a poster.
Right.
You know, it's just a matter of, as an artist, you want to get into that. You know, because it's like I was saying earlier, it's like, do you want to specialize in something, or do you want to be ready for anything, and you want to go after different aspect of, you know, the industry to do design and posters and storyboards and stuff like that. So it's really a choice more than anything.
And on some of this, it looks like you're drawing back on your animation roots.
Yeah. I mean, it's part of a process. Theme parks like films, you know, you start with ideas and rough and sketches, and then they either fine with that and they'll take it from there and they just model or just finish it for you and you don't have to worry. Or they would want you to push it, you know, to the final detail and stuff, and you never know, really. You just go with the flow with each art directors and production designers, and you know, listen to what they want, and, you know, you go with that. You know, so these were different projects for theme parks, the different things, I mean, that's the one actually that's being used outside.
That's right. Yeah. So this is the piece that, and Mark Gilpin and Ian Johnson, and again, the team at Spacey, Rick Villa, I think, is around here, too. It's a really good team that they have there, and Skip Howard is the owner of Spacey, and he's local in Dallas, so we're always trying to, and I think this was a good team up, because this was an experiment.
Yeah, totally. That was fun, you know. It's like, again, I had no idea, and I said, oh, God, because I've always been intrigued in trying to bring my paintings to animated, my paintings for film and stuff, and it's something I'm still very curious, and I would like to get into at some point, you know, but I'm too busy doing other things to just concentrate. But I know, and so doing this with these guys was like, oh, it's exactly doing that. It's like breaking down and dissecting a painting with all the Photoshop layers and stuff and make it happen like it could be my painting, animated my painting for a film shot. In that case, with their technology is different and it's cool. It's really cool to see that.
And, you know, there's other things, right, that you're continuing to work on?
Yeah, Star Trek, you know, it's one of the projects.
Oh, this is, as we get into magic, this is really cool. So talk about magic, right? So,
well,
you know, you're not busy enough, right?
No, it's what magic is perfect for me, because magic, these little cards, and I was approached by the art director years ago at the Comic-Con, and knew my work, and he says, would you like to work for magic? And I don't know much about the game, and it's just doing a cool concept. But I realized very quickly that you're working for creating a painting that's going to be in a little card that's just minuscule. And then, so it's really not about the art itself, more than it's about the game itself, you know, and they just want a little visual. But artistically, you know, you still have to put the energy you would put in doing an art piece. And so, because I knew you could own the work and sell the prints and stuff, I know I could work on an image that would be substantially detailed enough to be exciting to do. But I had to keep in mind that that thing's going to be printed so small that if I do too much detail in it, it's going to be nothing. So I had to learn a process that was very interesting to be very efficient in terms of not only quick to do a painting, because there was also some financial, you know, constraint as well. It's not like the budget was a film budget and stuff, so these cards, you know, it's... And so I had to make sense, you know, from that standpoint in terms of the amount of time I want to spend on an image, but also how to approach it so that it reads very, very quickly at the size it's going to be printed. And that kind of forced me to kind of rethink my painting approach and came up with something that's much looser, much quicker, you know, that's more direct. And that was very exciting because that was done at the time I was starting to get really into book covers, where I was exploring new painting techniques, you know, visually, and I completely fell into that, you know, and, you know, just kind of taught me a different way of doing design, doing painting, you know, how to be an artist in a different way, and not doing always the same thing, which was really cool.
And now we're coming back full circle, because it was those original books that were kind of inspiring to you and an influence, and now after all of these things you've done, you're now doing more publishing.
Yeah, and as much as I hate to show an image, you know, because it's one of the ugliest one ever. But it's still, because this is the first Photoshop image that I did.
Okay.
That was paid for. So it's so and that.
And they really paid.
Oh, they did. Yes. Yes. It's another aspect of the industry that we can talk about. But I'm sure you get paid. But yes, I was just starting to learn Photoshop. I was just the beginning of a Photoshop, Photoshop 4, when it's first starting having the layers on that. And I was so excited, I wanted to get into it. And I started playing around, and then that guy calls me, I had a project for a TV series, and I was learning Photoshop, and I says, well, let's just use it and see where it goes, you know. So, and what happened with that image is I submitted it to a Spectrum, and that image won the Silver Award on Spectrum that year. And honestly,
you were surprised.
Well, not only surprised, but it's like, in retrospect, yes, I understand why. Because it's like today, I would put that image on Spectrum, you would never make it.
Right.
And that tells you how competitive the industry has become from the day I posted that. What made that image so relevant and unique at the time is that it had never been done before. Photoshop did not exist in the book cover industry. That was not, it was a new tool that hadn't been explored fully as it is now by everyone. And so when they first saw an image, they really reacted to it and said, oh my God, never seen anything like it. Because everything is usually very traditional and was traditional at the time. Photoshop was just the beginning. And that image was like, oh. So they responded to a new thing, a new technology that's happening, and they had not kind of got used to that. And so that got it to be appreciated for that. Not necessarily for the quality that it is, because if you look at it and you compare it to anything else, I don't have to do that. I mean, this one is like, in the trash. But, you know, put it in the context, that makes sense. And so that also got me into the book cover industry, because that image being in Spectrum got the attention of an agent that had never seen that before and says, well, you know, we like that. Would you like a representation? And what I did with these guys at the time, I had never worked in book covers, which is funny because I started as a kid buying all that stuff because of book covers, but never worked in it. And so I told my agent, I said, if you can get me into the book cover industry, I would love to get a representation. And that's how it started. you know, and something kind of interesting happened, which is something interesting to and relevant to talk about, because it's part of the artist growth process and how somehow with what you learn and the energy and the decision that you make can have a huge impact without really necessarily, you know, you knowing it. And what happened here is that image in Photoshop, when it was introduced in the book of industry, no one had done that before. And no one had done it in that way, because there was a good friend of mine, Rick Berry, who had done it before me, but it was very character-centric. No one had brought all that kind of film thinking, the narrative, this expensive landscape as being part of the storytelling with a digital tool, ever. You know, Michael Whelan had done that, but very traditional. So I was bringing something of that same nature, but digital. So I was pushing and introducing something very new to an industry that was completely unprepared for it, and it totally embraced it. Because the moment this stuff started to get out there, I was bombarded with phone calls. Everyone wanted these expensive landscapes and all this stuff because they realized, oh my God, you know, this is cool. And it's kind of funny because you are talking about an industry that works in parallel with everything that's happened around them in terms of films and games and stuff, but you would think there would be cross-pollination happening just by looking at what's being done on that side, and you would want, but no, not necessarily. The book cover was very entrenched. He's doing these very character-driven covers. That's the way it was. That's the way everybody understood book covers until you break the rule and you show them something different. He says, oh my God, wow. And then boom, and you change a whole industry. And so, and that would never happen really. I mean, if I had not done all that process of exploring all these years about wanting to do this in films and getting to the game and learning these tools like Photoshop and 3D, which is now also a big part of what I integrate to my book covers because it's part of the growth process. So all that stuff, you know, it can have huge impact without you knowing it. And that's the cool thing about it. You know, you go there, you go there with the goal of being a concept artist without necessarily realizing sometimes what a difference, but the kind of difference you could make in an industry and how valuable and important that could be. And that's exciting. That's super exciting.
Now, of course, this is one of my favorite pieces.
Yeah, what is that? I just wonder about that. It's like,
so the boy on the back of this character is my son, Benjamin, right? He's sitting, so Ben's right there, and I'm totally embarrassing now because he's 13, right? So at the end, I want to come back to this because we still got, I think, some more. So we'll come back to this piece, but I want to go through your collector pen because I've got a story for you. People who know me, story. So let's talk about your collector's prints. How did that happen? And I know you're working with Disney too on more of these. And I'm just kind of, for time's sake, I'm just going to keep moving forward.
Yeah, move forward. Yeah, I mean, this is just something I do right now because I have friends from the animation industry that created a business of licensing with Disney and all the big companies. And they just approached me one day and they said, "Would you like to do some paintings in the Disney universe?" That translated later on into Star Wars since Disney bought it. And the cool thing about that is that they said, we don't want you to copy Mickey Mouse and do exactly what, it's you as an artist and how you would approach that universe. So you have complete freedom to do what you want. And that brought me back to all my animation roots, what I used to do, what I used to love, and what I would have loved to do, what I never did, and suddenly doing it. Even more so on Star Wars, because I worked on the film, but there's so much constraint when you work on the film, and suddenly I could do a Star Wars painting, and I have absolutely no constraints, because I had no connection with the film. So I could do images that just resonated with me in terms of what I love about the Star Wars universe, the same way as what I love about the Disney universe, picking my characters and creating these paintings that just made sense to me, that were exciting to do.
Now, this piece spoke to me personally as we're putting together the deck because I'm almost drawn into the image, right? It's almost, if you've been lucky enough to be in the autumn and be in the forest, it kind of pulls you in to the environment, in my opinion, and I think it's absolutely beautiful now.
Well, thank you. Yeah. Thanks. I think it brings an interesting a point, too, when you say that it drives you in. Everyone at some point, as you're learning the process of becoming an artist, you're going to be pigeonholed into something that you do very well that people are going to be asking you. And that actually, I think, is a very good example of that, because I think what made me, I think, artistically who I am today is because I was able to create these images, like you said, where you're drawn into that. That's what I brought it into the book cover industry. You know, that's what they liked it so much. And so, but that became a trademark. You know, it's almost like, oh yeah, when they see an image like it, we'd say, well, that's a Martiniere thing. I can recognize that, a piece of that. So that's something interesting to know about artistically, and that's something rewarding. That's always cool to know that. As much as you keep learning and you keep working in industry and you make a living and stuff, you know, there's also that thing that somehow at some point you can establish the styling that's your own, that makes you, you know, unique out there, which is also making you more relevant because of the competition that exists in an industry. So when you can find that voice and that thing that makes you and wanted by the studios in one form or another, that's a good thing. Yeah.
So these last couple pieces that my clicker wants to snap through really quickly on, tell this story real quick, because these are tangible prints, right?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that market is a print market. So it's printed on canvases, you know, and it's a limited edition for collectors and stuff. But then, because the majority of the artists that they have are traditional by nature, they have an original that they can also sell at the end of the day. I don't, because I'm digital. And so I came up with the idea, because they wanted for their collectors to be able to own something original, unique. And so since I couldn't, I said, what about doing some original drawings? And I love doing drawings. You know, and again, that's just brought me back to what I used to love that I haven't done for ages, and tried to kind of offer, you know, to the collector's market something that would be unique and fun to do. You know, and that actually caught on very well. I mean, the response was very positive. People liked it. And also, again, they like it because I'm the only one doing it,
right?
And so it's a different way of owning something that's different from the type of artist, and that makes it, you know, even more exciting to do, because now you offer something that's very unique to you. You know, so that's cool. That is a cool thing.
So as we're coming back, and if my clicker and computer will let me, I want to go back and tell that story. But you know, I'm stepping back sideways and just realizing. So, okay, how this came about was, I think Stephan called me and he goes, hey Jay, you have a son who's about the same age of somebody I need for a cover, and I'd like to get a reference, right?
Yep.
And so that's kind of how that phone call happened, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Don't you have a son? And so I asked Benjamin, I said, hey Ben, my friend, he's an artist, he needs a reference, and you're about the age, and so would you want to go down to the studio and see this? And he goes, oh, okay. And so we get in the car, and I remember I was teaching that night, and I was going to go to your studio, and then I was going to go to class, or maybe class first, and then afterwards. But as we're driving to the studio, I'm telling Ben about it, right? And I'm saying, you know, this is a pretty cool thing you're going to get to do, because you're going to get to be on some art. You know, Stephan, you know, he's pretty famous, and, you know, people know him and stuff like this. And I look over, and he's starting to have tears. And I'm sitting there, and I go, hey, Ben, man, if you don't want to do this, we don't have to do this. I go, we can call Stephan. We can say, sorry, it's not going to work out, because I don't want you to do anything you don't want to do. And he goes, you don't understand. These are tears of happiness. And so
I'm having a baby moment.
Crazy. And so I want to say, I very much appreciate that you coming and spending this time with us today, because I know it means a lot to me, and it means a lot to some of these folks that haven't had a chance to see your body of work and to hear about, you know, what you do. And Stephan is one of the most giving, caring, sharing, talented people I know. And we're going to go grab some food after this. But what he wanted you to know is that he's going to be available in the Nihilum probably around 11-ish and be hanging out in the bar. And if you want to come and hang out with him, and meet him and ask him some questions. Please be nice to him. Right? That's be respectful and don't mob him and give him some space and stuff. But he's going to be available to kind of answer some questions if you want to stick around, right? So I just want to say that. But we are running kind of short time, so we'll do a little Q&A, and if we don't get to your question, know that he is going to be available a little bit later.
And I like his questions a lot. Just.
All right, so does, and it's a little hard to see with the lights, but does somebody have a question? Oh, cool. Way in the back. Go ahead. Brett Riley. All right, Brett. Oh, I did. That's right. Okay, thanks. Brett. Okay, so in addition to tonight at the Nairo, you're going to be hanging out at the Industry Giants, right?
Yes, that is correct.
Oh, and also doing reviews, right?
Yes. And actually, if we are on that thing, then I'm going to make the official announcement. I've already started to talk to some people, but I'm going to be starting a class. Teaching, finally decided to get into that.
All right.
For school is
yes. So the
announcement is going to be made in October. I'm doing a presentation in Dublin for that. So I'm working on that. It's going to be a long process because it's a 9-hour class to put together. It's a long thing. So it could take, 6 months, maybe more.
Sure.
But eventually there will be something to learn from me, hopefully.
Something to learn from you?
Yeah. Through tourism, so it'd be fun. We'll see what happens. I mean, I've always wanted to get into that, and I thought maybe it's the right time to start.
And you have a newsletter and stuff, too, that people can subscribe.
Yes, and actually, yes. If you go to my website, if you guys are interested to keep up, and I give updates on a monthly basis, I do a newsletter where I tell people what's going on with me, what I'm doing for films, and talk about arts and process and what have you. It's very different every time. You're welcome to sign in for that and be part of a newsletter thing, yes.
Okay. Oh, what time tomorrow? When Industry Giants opens up, so you do have to have an Industry Giants ticket to get into Industry Giants. If you are a BD member, we also allow you to come hang out with us. Right, that's part of the agreement that Brian and I said. So if you have a Big D ticket, you can, and you want to come hang out with some of the industry giants. Seating may be limited because I think this is the biggest year ever. So I want to give also a shout out to all the industry giants team and also the Big D team because this really wouldn't be possible without the support of Brian Sullivan and the Big D team. So we really thank and appreciate it because every year they have been so incredibly supportive. And Brian, in my opinion, is a visionary because he saw value in the design and the aesthetic and the problem solving that the film industry and game industry brings. And that's a special kind of person that can open their place and their conference up and have this partnership that we've done for years. And I think it's really going to pay off as the industry kind of comes together in the future. I do maybe a few more questions. Does somebody have a burning question? Thanks for that. Any questions? Yes, go ahead. Okay, the question, and I'll rephrase, because you're working for Toyota during the day, but you like sci-fi stuff, is how do you get reference material for stuff that doesn't exist?
Yeah, well, if you find out, you tell me, because... I collect images. I have thousands and thousands of folders of different images, all categorized based on how I want to use it. That's grows it every day because I'm always on the internet because that's part of my research process. As to things that don't exist, well, that comes from what you do with these images because obviously if it's already there, it's there. And I think that's where artistically you come in. You know, you you have to be able to kind of gather all the images that you think for the ideas are relevant. But then, with that, what do you do with it? Because frankly, I mean, in life, there's nothing original. I mean, in anything that's been created continuously, it's already from something that's already been there. It's just a remanipulation and a reinterpretation of something that you're already familiar with that gives it a new twist. So there's nothing really magical in a sense that it's out there. It's really what you do with it. So the best thing that you can do artistically, especially when you're thinking about ideas, science fiction ideas, and doing something different, is do research as much as you can to bombard yourself with ideas. Because every image you're going to receive is going to give you different possibilities. You could see something that says, oh, it's kind of cool, I like that for what it is because of its design or its shape. And then you pick another image and you start thinking, how can I use that? Because I like that too. Can it be mixed together? Can it work? And it's always based on your idea to start with. You know, what is the goal? You know, to give you a very quick example, when I was doing that commercial for plant design, I was asked to do a plant, and the idea was like, you know, the big movie with that giant plant stuff, Audrey.
Little
shop of horrors. We want a little shop of horror kind of creature for a commercial because, you know, that's just what it is. Well, there's two scenarios here. You could just go and start designing from what you think you remember, and then most likely you're going to fail because it's only very limited what you remember or what you think a plant could look like or what it's supposed to be. And if they already told you Audrey, you're going to start drawing something that looks like Audrey. So you're not going to really push the envelope in there. Or the other thing, which is what I do all the time, is I go online and I start typing carnivorous plants. Every kind of word that relates to the idea of what these people are trying to do. And suddenly, I start looking at image and I discover stuff I have never seen before. And that's when it becomes magic. Because when you see these things, you realize, oh my God, I knew nothing. I thought I didn't know about what a plant monster could be, but really it's just a portion of what's really out there at your disposal for research. And when you start gathering all that stuff and putting it together, and now you have all that stuff in front of you, then your brain starts to make the creation. You start putting elements from here and here. An alien creature is another example. Alien, the alien that was so iconic, when you dissect alien, there is nothing unusual about it. It's just how you remanipulated things that are known to everyone to tap into very specific emotions to scare you. So you get the bones, you get the insects, you get a lot of things that are very common, but he was able to put it in one shape that scared the hell out of everyone. But in essence, it's not something you've never seen before. It's a rethinking of something that resonates with you, and that's what makes it powerful too. Because you don't want to go too far too in thinking it has to be so never seen before that you don't get it. Because then you have no more connection with your audience. You need to be able to connect and have elements that are always relevant. So if you say, oh yeah, I understand the functioning, even if it's supposed to be sci-fi and stuff, or I understand where it's coming from, what it's supposed to be, or communicate to me in terms of emotion, and that's how you want to approach it.
I'll add to that, and I'll say this, I like macro photography, right? It's going beyond what we can see, right? And there's a book called Look, that's hard to get now because I think it's out of print or something like that, but it talks about different lenses that you can look at things, whether it's binoculars or magnifying glass or a microscope, and it's looking at those ordinary objects that are around us every day in different ways, right? And be inspired by what, and nature is absolutely incredible.
Oh, it's all there.
Right. Yeah. So it's just drawing upon this thing.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of funny because the more you grow up, the more you realize you don't know squat. I mean, you think you do, and you have to learn to figure that out, but then, especially with the age of the internet, I mean, before the internet, I was just relying on books, and if I don't have a library next door, if I don't go to the bookstore because I don't have one next to me, I'm very limited. But the internet changed everything. I mean, it exploded, and it opened up so much more potential because now you have access to everything, and you have, that's when you realize, oh my God, so much stuff I don't know that could be used, you know, to do what you do. Yeah.
That was a very good question. We got time for one more question. All right, in the blue shirt. Yes.
could speak up. So yeah, so the question is about, do you want to continue with traditional skills you've learned or just discard that and become completely digital, right? Oh, and the consequences of that? Well, I would say never lose a traditional. To me, I think it's what made you, you know, I mean, to me at least, and it's still very relevant. If you look at how I work right now, and I worked on theme parks and film and stuff, I'm always at some point take a pencil and sketch. Now you could now sketch with a Cintiq and do some very sketch stuff, and that's one thing. But if you've been trained and you've learned traditional, I think it's a great skill to have. Because, for example, if I get to the collector's market and now I want to produce some original drawings for clients, I could never do that on a Cintiq. Do you see? So there's something to be said about keeping these traditional skills because they're always relevant. They are the foundation of who you are as an artist. After that, digital becomes a tool. It's an additional tool to your arsenal, like 3D, like any new technology that's going to help create new possibilities, but never discard, you know, what made you from the start, you know, what you are artistically, because it's always valuable.
So I'll add to that and say there has been some research done, especially in Harvard, for instance, on note-taking, that students who take notes on their laptop don't retain the information as much as they do when they're drawing in notepads. I believe also when you're drawing on paper, real paper, pencils on paper, your brain responds differently than when you're engaging in a digital interface. And I think practicing both means you're using different parts of your brain, and I think you're just building those creative muscles. So that's my
that's a good point. Yeah, it's a good point. I mean, I totally believe in that. Yeah.
So, all right, guys. It's getting late, right? Thank you guys very much. Don't forget to come back tomorrow if you have your Giants tickets. And you can meet Stephan at the bar at the Nilo later on tonight, or come back to Into Giants. Guys, be safe, and I'll see you all later.
I know, that's what you needed forward.
I bet that's not a kidney stone.
Hey, man. How are you? Good.